Cincinnati, Brian Orser warms up for the men's singles showdown, miles away from his home in Canada, where the journey began. On a winter day in Orillia, Ontario, memories for Brian Orser are as bitter as the Canadian cold. Memories of a nightmarish night in Geneva a year ago.
Martin Brian Orser, Canada.
With a chance again for the gold, Orser fell on a jump he owns, the triple axel. And for the third straight year, Orser had to settle for second place.
Oh, I know it was on a silver platter. It was right there for me, and I realized that's what was so frustrating afterwards. More frustrating than other years, because other years I did the best I could to get to second place. You know, I was coming from seventh or sixth in figures and worked my way up to second and doing the best I could. And then last year, all I had to do was win the long program. And that was frustrating after, because it was there for me.
And so it was back to the solitary confinement of the practice ring. Tracing the endless figures which had plagued him each year in the past. He had ample time to wonder if he would ever stand on the center platform, winner of the gold, like Scott Hamilton in 1984. With Hamilton gone, 1985 was to be Orser's year. But it turned out to be the same. Second place again, this time to Alexander Fadeev. Last year at Geneva, the planet seemed in the right configuration for Orser. Fadeev, skating first, stumbled out of contention for the gold. And while America's Brian Boitano skated a clean performance, he had trailed Orser into the final program. So it was up to Orser. A solid mistake-free program would give him the gold at last.
Next is the most difficult combination to be done in the competition. Triple axel. Oh, and he falls. He has been hitting that all week without any difficulty at all.
As he awaited the marks, Orser feared the worst. Could it be second place again?
5-7, 5-8, 5-7, 5-8, 5-7, 5-8.
Thank you.
Fadeev first.
Boitano first.
While Fadeev and Boitano were skating, I stayed in this small makeup room with the shower running, so I couldn't hear the marks or I couldn't hear the applause and that sort of thing, which is very out of the norm for me. So what we came to was that I have to just deal with reality as it's coming along. And if Boitano is skating well and I can hear the audience, then just deal with it.
Dealing with it included broadening his horizons, removing skating as the all-consuming focus of his life. Brian took up other sports and new interests, including a new business venture.
I wanted to open up the visors and so I wouldn't have just sort of tunnel vision just for skating, because I'm 25 now and I've sort of had to keep my eyes open and look around and see what's happening, as well as keep myself on target as far as what I want to do with skating and as a competitor.
At 25, many other skaters have left their best performances on the ice. But Orser sought new ways to win the world championship he still longed for. A sports psychologist became his daily guru, helping him to think more positively, to concentrate more intensely, and to believe in himself.
Every distraction to further center you. Mm-hmm. You know, like turn them into, don't fight them, just, it's like when you're relaxing, you hear a noise in the room and you use that to take you even further. Mm-hmm.
With his coach and psychologist watching, Orser's new training routine includes simulation of the performance before he skates. A routine he repeated over and over for 6 months prior to Cincinnati. It's an imitation he hopes he can finally translate into real gold.
I know here in Canada, there's a lot of people that have sort of given up hope. And even with some of the press, they've given up hope because they think, you know, always a bridesmaid and, you know, will he ever do it? And, you know, in the same article saying, no, he probably won't. And I read these things and that just makes me fight even more.
We'll be back to see if Brian Orser has finally put it all together.